never sways. You'll never let go. This love is bio, bio. You got me reaching for the sky. Now I'm spinning over. Why? You'll never let go. This love is bio, bio.
Taking all the old go. Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a humble donkey, where people shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David." And I think it's easy for us to sort of insert ourselves into the story and think of ourselves there and be like, yes, I can get on board with that. I can cheer for Jesus. I can shout Hosanna and remove ourselves from the story before the end of the week. I think we're at the benefit of having hindsight in history. We can look back and say, oh, I know what's coming. And to remove ourselves from that as if we have no part in that. But Isaiah 53, verse 6, says, we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. And so I want to remind us that it's good to sing Hosanna, to praise the Son of David, to praise King Jesus. But let's offer it bound up with humility as well, because we have a role in his death.
We're going to continue to worship. And if people are still coming in, so if we could do the journey shuffle, if there are seats in between, let's scooch in, because people are still checking their kids in and going around the parking lot, and we want to make sure they can come and worship with us.
final breath and it was finished. But not at the end I could have known. For the earth began to shake and the veil was torn. With sacrifices made as the
up Jesus like he's worthy of it today. Jesus. Oh, Praise God. Stay standing for just a moment. You know, it's a special day today. It's Palm Sunday, and perhaps you don't know or get what Palm Sunday is. They put some palm branches on the stage right there to signify Palm Sunday, but it's a special day for us because it's a day that signifies Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem, but it's the day that starts what we in Christendom call the Passion Week. And this is the week of God's passion revealed for us, that Jesus comes into Jerusalem knowing exactly what's about to happen and doing so on mission. And 5 days later, choosing to leave Jerusalem, the gates of the holy city, as a criminal for you and for me. And that's Good Friday. And next week culminates Passion Week with the greatest event of all time, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And what a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful time that we get to gather and celebrate Jesus. Can we give a shout out to Jesus one more time, like our resurrected King? Hosanna, they would shout. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And that means save us, we pray. Praise God, He did it. He did it. Amen. Well, why don't you look at your neighbor and say you look good, and then grab a seat as you sit down. I want to welcome everybody who's watching online as a part of our online crowd. Just want to welcome you wherever you're watching from. I know God wants to meet you, speak to you right wherever you are. Well, hey guys, it's so great to be with you. If you haven't had the chance to meet yet, my name is Luke. I'm pastor here at Journey Church, and it's such an honor and a privilege to be a part of such a wonderful and dynamic place to worship and to connect with each other and with Jesus Christ as the local church. And man, I'll tell you, it's my favorite place on earth right here, Journey Church. I'm not feeling at the top of my health today. You can kind of feel it in my voice or hear it in my voice. And so we've got some special things in store for you. But man, there's no place I would rather be than in the house of God together with us as we worship and we lift up the name of Jesus Christ. If you're here for the very first time, you're visiting with us or came with some friends or family, wherever might have brought you in, I want you to first and foremost know that of all the places you could be and of all the things that you could do on a weekend in Central Oregon to hang out with us, man, that's huge. That's a massive honor on our behalf. And I just want you to know that we're so grateful for you. We've got connection cards in the seats in front of you, as well as digital versions of those connection cards. There's a little QR code you can see. You can scan that with your phone, or you can just grab the actual connection card, or you can scan the QR code that's on the screen. It's all the same. And here's what we'd love to do. We'd just love to get to know you. We'd love to get some information about you. We're not going to solicit you or stalk you or call you or put you on one of those annoying lists. We won't sell your info to somebody else to call you. We won't do that. Here's what we'd love to do. We'd love to pray for you. We'd love to go before God on your behalf and just let you know that we're honored that we get to have you in our presence today. And if there's any way that we could pray for you or just being on in prayer with you or praise for you, we'd love to be a part of that in your story. And you can fill that out. You can drop it in the offering receptacles as you exit on both sides of the door, or as you leave today at our scoop information desk, you can just drop those right off, or just fill it out digitally. It just goes right into the website, and we'll follow up with you this week as we follow up. And we are just so honored, so grateful for you to be a part of what God is doing here today at Journey Church. You know, at Journey, we believe truly in what we call biblical stewardship. And what I mean by biblical stewardship is that we believe that God is the source of our provision. It's not our hustle, it's not our grit, it's not our government that determines our provision. It's our God, and that He owns all things, and that what we have comes through the grace and through the mercy of Him. And because of that, we give to God what is His. That is the tithe and the offering, the first and the best of the fruits of our lives, of our work and of our wages. And we want to invite you to be a part of doing that with us. The Bible talks about bringing those gifts into the storehouse, the place that feeds you spiritually. That's the local church. And if you are a part of Journey, we'd love to invite you to be a part of what God is doing here and investing and sowing into the kingdom of God through this local church ministry, as well as what we do with partnering around the world with missions and our local outreach charities as well. We just are so grateful to make an impact locally as well as globally in this ministry. In just a few short years, God has allowed us as a church to make very significant impacts. And we're so we're so grateful for that support. If you're new here, I don't want you to feel like we're coercing or we want anything from you. We don't expect anything from you. If God leads you to give, we'd love to say yes to that partnership, but we're just so grateful for your presence here today. But I would encourage you, step out in faith, to trust God, not your government, not your boss, not your hustle, to trust your God as a source of your provision. The Bible says, God says, I will bless you if you try this, he says. And so we want to encourage you to be a part of biblical stewardship, of trusting God in that. And there's just a couple of simple ways to give. We don't pass a bucket. We don't do anything like that. We've got offering receptacles at the exit doors. You can give your gift physically if you'd like to do that. You could write a check if you'd like to do that. Or you can give online. Just visit us at journeyinredmond.com. There's a little give button at the top or on the bottom of the page, or just /give. There's lots of ways to give on our give portion of that. You can give also through our church app. We have an app that's called Church Center. And through the Church Center app, you can give. You can set up automatic giving or recurring giving. It's super simple. It's super easy. The easiest way to do that, honestly, is just this. It's just to text the amount that you want to give to the number 84321. It's so simple, so easy. It'll automatically ping you back with a link to set up what church you want to give that to. Based on your location, it'll pinpoint Journey Church. You select that as the church I want to give to. And then from that point on, you can set it to continually do that. It's so simple, super easy. We, you know, technology makes it so convenient for us to do these things. And so we're so grateful for that. We've got a couple of things coming up here at church I want to make you aware of and just invite you to be a part of. One of those is today, happening right after this service in the hub over there. We're in the process of kind of slowly and systematically remodeling some of the odd spaces that this building has had to try to make as much room as we can. And we're so glad to say that we got a part of our hub opened up last week, and that's for our middle schoolers and things like that. But in our 11:45 service, we have something called Fast Track. And if Journey Church is your home, or if this is the place that you call it your church and you've yet to be a part of Fast Track, I want to encourage you, strongly encourage you to be a part of that. Because here's what Fast Track is. It's membership. It's what joining a church is all about. Listen, a lot of times we want to just casually date, but there's something about saying, I'm going to join this. I'm going to connect with this. I'm going to put my investment as they put their investment into me, and we're going to do this together. It's about joining the church. It's also about discovering and unlocking who God has created you to be through your personality and through your spiritual giftings. We want to help you discover what your spiritual giftings are, because God created you to do something. My dad used to say this to his church all the time, that every believer in Christ is a full-time minister of the gospel. Just because you don't get paid to do it doesn't mean that God hasn't commissioned you to be a minister of the gospel. And God wants to help you unlock what his gifts are to live out what that calling looks like. And we want to help start that process today. That happens right after this service at 11:45 in the hub. If you've got kids in kids' church, man, they'll be cool, especially if they're in the elementary. They just get more Journey bucks. Like, they're just like, you got me more money? I'm cool with that. Like, they're good for that. And so they'll have a great time. And that happens at 11:45 today. The second announcement is that this is Passion Week. So that changes a couple of things about our services. First and foremost, we don't have any pursuit night this Wednesday at 6:33. Every Wednesday we have pursuit night. We're not having a pursuit night this Wednesday because we're having a Good Friday communion service instead. So we're having service on Friday at 6:00. We're going to gather together. We're going to worship some. We're going to lean into what the body and the blood of Jesus Christ mean to us as we, the church, together come in unison and we receive communion and commemoration for what Jesus Christ has done for us. So I want to invite you to come out to our Good Friday communion service. If you can get here a little early, I think it's going to be pretty full. So I want to try to get you as many seats as you can before it fills in. But that's going to happen on Friday. And we've got Easter Sunday. Can you believe it is Easter Sunday next week? I mean, where does time go? But here we are at Easter Sunday, and we've got three Easter services, 8:15, 10, and 11:45. And they're at the same exact time as normal. But here's the detail. They're not here. Like if you show up to church here, there's nobody gonna be here. The only people are gonna be here are gonna be like the volunteers running back here because we forgot something to set up and you met them while they were here and you're like, oh, there was one other person at Journey's Easter service. No, we're not here. We're at Ridgeview High School's Performing Arts Auditorium and Gymnasium. We've got space for the kids to run and stretch. We're gonna have Easter egg hunts for the kids during the services and we got room to play in the auditorium so that you're not like, you know, trying to worship Jesus a journey like you are here like this. Like we just want to be able to stretch out a little bit. But the question I have for you is, who are you inviting? I can't tell you how many stories I've heard over the years of people that have come to church on Easter because their friend, their family invited them. They had nothing else to do. They didn't really know what it was about, but they said yes. And that's when they met Jesus Christ. That's when their life changed. That's when everything about their world started transforming. And listen, I bet you right now in your circle of influence, the Greek word is the metron. Paul talks about this sphere of influence that God gives each and every one of us, that you've got coworkers, you've got family members, you've got friends right now that need to know the gospel and the good news of Jesus Christ. So the question is, who are you going to invite to Easter service with you this week? That invite could very well change somebody's life and their eternity. And so you don't want to miss that opportunity. It's one of the best soul-winning weekends we have at Journey Church is Easter weekend. I can't wait to see all the people decide to choose Jesus Christ. And so we can't wait to worship with you next week. Well, like I said, you can hear it in my voice. I'm not feeling the best. And if you didn't hear the news last week, if you weren't in church last week, I kind of subtly announced at the end of the service that my mom and my dad, as they had come up to visit us last weekend, they live in Eagle Crest part-time, that on Saturday night or Sunday morning late or early Sunday morning, my dad, my hero, he passed away in his sleep suddenly and unexpectedly and kind of left us as a family just shattered and a little bit kind of just all over the place emotionally. I came in, I still preached, and I did that because I know my dad would want me to do that. That was what my dad's favorite thing is. Sundays were my dad's favorite day. And, I wasn't even necessarily going to come today because not only did we deal with that, we've got some other things familial going on. And then I got sick and I've been really sick all week. I went to the doctor and the doctor told me I have a lower respiratory infection and water in my lungs. And he says, you're at high risk of getting pneumonia. You need to just chill and rest. So I'm on some heavy medication and try and just right now not to cough on all of you. And so I called one of my friends and I said, to one of my friends, Pastor Keith from Journey Church in Bend. And I said, Pastor, this is Friday. I said, I need somebody to help me. I don't think I could preach on Sunday. This is what being a part of a family is. People often ask us what our association, our affiliation is with Bend. And we're family. That's what family is. You know, I've got sisters. They do what they do. And I do what I do. And when you call, they answer. Or when they call, you answer. Or they would say, I don't answer the phone, but that's okay because I don't answer my phone, but you step up for family. And so Pastor Keith said, I got you covered. And so he said, I got a guy that I'm gonna bring in for you. And he's a part of Journey here in Bend and we're bringing him up and we're putting him into positions and God's got a great call on this man's life. And so Pastor Keith introduced me to a great guy today that you're gonna get the chance to hear. His name's Joel Bauer in just a moment. I'll introduce him in just a moment. But before I do, my mom made me come. She said, you gotta get up on stage today. And she said, listen, I need you to tell your church. Well, listen, she said, I need you to tell your church. My mom pastored for 45 years. My sister is a church planter as well for 25 years. My other sister pastoring for 20 years. And she said, listen, I need you to get up there and I need you to tell your church that we have never experienced grace and we have never experienced overwhelming love like we have from the people at Journey Church for the 3 days that they were in Central Oregon. They said that they were overwhelmed by how many people reached out. People were a part of a meal train, bringing food and flowers. And they said they have never experienced anything in all of their years quite like the love of what Journey Church had to offer. My mom said, you have to get up on that stage and you need to tell that church from me, I love you. She says, you are, she is part of this church. You know, that she comes here half the time of the year. The other time she lives in Southern California. We're trying to get her up here all the time, but it's all right. But she said this is her church and she's just so proud of you. She loves you guys so much. And so as your pastor, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for keeping us in your prayers. Thank you for covering us. God's got us. And I know that. I know my dad is where he's supposed to be. I miss him. You know, he was my rock. There wasn't a week I did not call him and talk to him about you. But at the same time, you know what? I know that he's where he wouldn't come back if he could. And that's all right. That's all right. We'll see him again. But today's a special day. It's Palm Sunday. We're going to hear about the message of a king entering his kingdom and preaching about his kingdom. And I'm excited to introduce to you an awesome guy that I literally just met on Friday via text message and met in person today as I walked into church because my buddy Keith said, listen, I got a guy that I know he's going to do a great job and I know he would do honor for the message. And so I want to, in just a moment, bring up to the stage Joel Bauer. But Joel is somebody who's special at Journey. He's been entrusted with leading some groups and stepping into young adults ministry. Now talking about seventh graders, and Joel don't know that. I talked about eighth graders last week and how hard eighth graders were, so we can understand some of that. But Joel's gonna come up. He's gonna teach us the last part of the series that we've been in called The Road to Calvary. Before we do, I'm gonna pray. I'm just gonna invite God to come and speak to us, to lead us, to guide us in what God would have for us, to anoint this service. So would you join me? Let's just go before God. Father, we thank you for the opportunity today to step into the word, to step into the anointing and the teachings of your Holy Spirit. God, I pray that you would cover Joel through your word. God, I pray that you would anoint his words. I pray that you would open our hearts to see, our minds to receive, and our ears to hear what you have for us today. And God, may we stand and live in the kingdom of Jesus Christ forevermore. Amen. Well, hey friends, this is my buddy Joel. Would you give it up for Joel? He's going to preach to us today. Joel, take it away, my friend.
Thanks for being here. And for those online, thanks for joining us. Before I get into it, I do just want to mention that Journey Church Bend, we, like Luke said, we are family. And I know that Journey Church Bend is praying for you, Luke. Pastor Keith has let folks know. And, our hearts just break for you. So glad we could show up in your time of need. Since I don't know any of you, except for my friend Kyle here, who I went to Uganda with in November, I grew up in Oregon. I'm from Springfield, and I was really blessed to have a Christian family. My grandparents prayed for it, my parents prayed for it, and I'm where I am today largely because of those prayers. But I had a really limited idea of what life as a Christian was. I thought it was just following rules, and when I was a senior in high school, I saw other people living a different way. And I thought, hey, that looks pretty fun. I'm going to try that out. And at the end of that road, I found it was really empty. And what I was looking for in fulfillment, I just found nothing. And I looked back on my life and I thought, man, what was different before? Oh, yeah, I was just following a bunch of those rules. And in following those rules, I was actually understanding and living in the way that God created me to live. So I reached out to some mentors and some youth leaders and a young life leader, and I said, hey, how do I read my Bible? How do I pray? And in the process of that, I built this relationship with Jesus. And throughout that, you know, we're going to talk today about the kingdom of heaven, and a lot of the kingdom of heaven might sound like a bunch of rules. But what I hope you understand by the end of today's sermon is that Jesus has created us for a relationship. And the kingdom of heaven here on earth, as he preached it in the Gospels 126 times, is showing us what that relationship with him looks like. So with that, I'm going to pray, and then we can get started. Father God, thank you for an opportunity to share the gospel. Pray that you would speak through me today. These would not be my words, Lord, but they would be your words. And as we open the word, Lord, would it penetrate hearts? And throughout this week, God, would people just continue to turn to your scripture, to turn to you in prayer, and spend time with you? In Jesus' name, amen. Well, before we open up the scripture, I do just want to continue kind of a recap of where we've been on this road to Calvary. At the beginning of this sermon series, Luke shared what the resurrection was and how it makes Jesus knowable, that we can know God. What a powerful blessing to know the Creator. The following week, we saw that the cross covers our debts, our sin, and in that, we can find freedom. That as Christians, we get to live this full life. Jesus and John 10:10 says, life and life to the fullest, or some translations say, life more abundantly. And what a blessing to find freedom in that. And last week, getting to hear how when Jesus passed, that the curtain in the temple was torn in half, that curtain that separated everyone else from the holy presence of God. And the reason that's so significant is because that symbolized God living in us, that God didn't want to live separated. God wanted to be a part of our lives. God wanted to be in every part, all of it, the messy stuff, the hard stuff, the good stuff. He wanted to be in that. And in understanding that God lives in us and through us, we discover our purpose. And this week, as we talk about Palm Sunday, we'll discover how Jesus invites us to live in this kingdom of heaven today. Not to wait for heaven when we die, but what it looks like to live heaven on earth here. That our lives would be directed by this invitation to live for something greater. To really make a difference. What that looks like, making a difference in our life with God through us, and how it makes a difference in others' lives with God through us. So if you have a Bible, would you just hold it in the air? Wave it around a little bit. Ooh, I have to report, you guys have more Bibles in this service than the first service, so congratulations. If you're using the Bible app, that's fine. Just know that if you are checking scores for March Madness games, I will know. I can tell. Today's scripture is in Matthew 21, starting in verse 1. Says this, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. But if anyone asks anything of you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. This prophecy was one of over 300 prophecies that Jesus fulfilled. 300 that he fulfilled to prove that he is the Messiah. The Messiah means liberator. The Jewish people were looking for someone to liberate them because they were under Roman occupation. And they had been occupied by lots of people before that, including the Babylonians. And they just went from one oppressor to another oppressor to another oppressor. And they had this history of understanding who the Messiah would be through the scriptures of the Old Testament. And they knew that the Messiah would come and liberate the Jewish people. So they were waiting for a king to deliver them. They were waiting for a king to deliver them from their oppressors. And they were wondering, could this Messiah, this Jesus, could he be the one? Could he be it? They wondered if this was finally the moment. Well, the disciples went and did as Jesus instructed them, and they brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road while others cut branches from the streets and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city stirred and asked, who is this? And the crowds answered, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. This is the word of God. You guys, riding a donkey is really kind of an odd thing in this scenario. And the reason is, this is Jesus proclaiming himself as King of the Jews, as the Messiah, as he enters into town. And typically, when someone enters a town like that, they go on a horse. Kings rode horses into battle. They were powerful. They were majestic. They were strong. It showed this dominance. It showed, we're here to mess things up and make change. And I love using AI to make some paintings. So I had an AI painting of a very powerful horse. It's very strong. And then this is Jesus on a donkey. Not as powerful, is it? Not the same image. You know, when Jesus was walking into town, they were screaming, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna," which means save us, save us. And then he came in on a donkey. I think they might have been expecting a horse. And maybe that's why 5 days later they were yelling, "Crucify, crucify, crucify." Probably not just the donkey, but the donkey might have had something to do with it. Why a donkey, though? Why a donkey? If a horse displays power, a donkey displays peace. Jesus, the Messiah, the King of the Jews, did not come as they were expecting, a triumphant general king to overthrow a government. He came to overthrow sin. He came to defeat sin and death. That's why he came. That's why he came on a donkey bringing peace. There were many groups in the Jewish society waiting for the Messiah to come, the Sadducees and Pharisees, who later in the week really orchestrated the crucifixion itself. But there was another group, the Zealots, who were also anxiously awaiting the Messiah. Does anyone familiar with the Zealots? Put a hand in the air if you've heard of the term Zealots as a group of people in Jewish history. Okay, a good number. Essentially, these were the most hardcore of the Jewish people who hated Roman occupation. Most people were like, "Oh yeah, Rome, it sucks that they're over us, but hey, nice roads, aqueducts, pretty good." And the Zealots were like, "Screw those guys, they're the worst, we hate them." And they were really like taking it to them through guerrilla warfare tactics, attacking them when they could, plotting against them. It was really an aggressive attack against Rome and all that they did. And Jesus just so happened to hang out with one of those guys. His name was Simon the Zealot. I'm sure you've heard of Simon Peter, but one of the other 12s was Simon the Zealot. And when Jesus, I'll speak truthfully, the scriptures only said that Jesus sent two of his disciples. It doesn't name them. I checked all the other gospels to make sure, like, just give any hints, and it doesn't name them. But I like to think that he would have sent Simon the Zealot. Why? Because Simon the Zealot was probably expecting Jesus to ride in on a horse. He's like, "Yes, this is it. This is finally the time. Here we go. We're taking over. Let's go." And then Jesus describes how he will find a donkey. And he'll just take the donkey. And if anyone asks about why he's taking their donkey, he'll just be like, "Oh no, Jesus needs it." And they'll be like, "Oh yeah, that makes sense." And I can imagine if Simon was going with the other disciple to find that donkey, he might have been spotting horses along the way, thinking, "Well, maybe we should just take a horse. That Clydesdale's massive. Can you imagine Jesus on a Clydesdale? That's way more impressive than a donkey. A donkey is a puny. And the foal of a donkey, the colt, is the baby. It said it's never been ridden before. So you can just imagine Jesus is probably having to walk alongside of it. Have you ever stood on top of a big dog? And you're like, "You can't sit on a dog, but you can pretend to ride it." I just feel like Jesus is probably pretending to ride the donkey. I don't even know if it was really carrying him or not. But I love that in this image of me imagining Simon the Zealot being the one to go do this, I imagine that the other disciple was like, "No, Jesus said," and Simon's like, "Fine, yeah, he's never been wrong yet. Yet, but he could be. He could be about this thing. Maybe we should get a horse." You know, there's a phrase that I love called "actions speak louder than words," and a phrase that I dislike, it's the thought that counts. Because if it's the thought that counts, well, if I thought about calling my dad but never called him, would he know that I'm thinking about him? If I thought about working out, do you think I could get strong just from thinking about it? It's the thought that counts. If I thought about saving a lot of money so that I could be rich someday, but I didn't do anything about saving that money so that I could retire, it's not the thought that counts. Actions speak louder than words. And that day, if it was in fact Simon the Zealot, which who knows, it might not have been, But in this imaginary scenario that I'm thinking of, where he's walking down, you know, he probably wanted that Clydesdale. But his actions spoke louder than his thoughts or his words. He was obedient to Jesus, and he got the donkey. And I think that obedience part is a really interesting one we struggle with as a Christian. I won't speak for you. I'll speak for me. As a Christian, I struggle with obedience. When I pray, when I talk to people about my plans, I'm often the one telling, God, do this for that person and this for me, and God, do that and this and that. And God, I want now. But God knows better than me. If God's the creator of the whole universe, he definitely knows more than I do. He knows a lot better than me on what to do. And in this scenario, when the people were expecting Jesus to ride in on a horse to claim his throne, to be the king they were expecting, as they threw out this carpet in front of him of palm branches and coats, and he came differently. He came on a donkey bringing peace. That was unexpected. You know, Jesus, in his ministry, he taught one thing over and over, 126 times through the Gospels, and including in Matthew, it was something like over 50 times. He taught about the kingdom of heaven being here now. Mark 1:14-15 says, "Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.'" The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. The gospel means good news. He's out declaring the good news. And he says this challenge to repent and believe the good news. Repent means to turn away from something, to walk the other direction. Children instinctively do this when they touch something hot. They'll jerk their hand back and go, "Ow, hot." They don't keep their hand on it and go, "That's hot." But oftentimes in my sin, I keep my hand on that burner. I go, "I'm not supposed to do this. But it's fun because someone said it's fun." And then in the end, I just get really hurt. Thanks be to God for his grace. I don't have to live in that. And that's where repent comes in. Repent and hear the good news. What's the good news? Well, the good news is that the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. That means it's here. That means today, in this place, in this building, in Redmond, Oregon, the kingdom of God is here. Wow. Can you just feel it a little bit? I did during worship. I'll be honest. This is one of those thin places between heaven and earth where you just feel the emotion coming through. And it's not because the musicians, who are fantastic, by the way, it's not because they are so special. It's not because the lights are something magical. It's because the Spirit of God is in this group. And as I looked out among you guys, I'm from Journey and Bend. And the reason I stuck with Journey and Bend when I moved here and I was finding a church was all the people there, when I was looking around during worship, they were here for Jesus. When I looked at the people on stage, including the pastors, I was like, "Oh, huh. They don't just spend time with God to prepare for a message. They read their Bibles because they're hanging out with Jesus." And that's true here. Heaven on earth. That thin place, that kingdom come. Many of us think that the kingdom of heaven is just a place where we go when we die. It's much more than just a destination, friends. It's a present reality setting in on us. In Jesus' famous Sermon on the Mount, which summarizes what life in the kingdom looked like, he taught in Matthew 5:20, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Never enter. Who were the scribes and the Pharisees? They were the elite religious people. They were the ones who, If you gave them a test and put them on a lie detector and you're like, have you ever sworn? Have you ever taken the Lord's name in vain? Have you ever done, you know, go down all the commandments, go through all the laws, go through the book of the Torah, go through everything. Go through it all and say, have you ever done this or that? They were the ones who would confidently say, no, I haven't. And if ever I thought about doing it, I made a sacrifice to cleanse me of my sins. They were the holiest of the holy people in that time. And Jesus says, unless your righteousness exceeds that, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. How do we get there then? If I can't be good enough, how do I get there? If it's not about works, what do I need to do? But thanks be to God through Jesus' death and resurrection on the cross that made the way as Jesus comes in this triumphal entry as king over the earth to take care of our sins. The entrance into the heavenly kingdom isn't about looking the part, it's about living the part. And you can only live that. You can only do that through Jesus. Done how? How? Mercy, grace, cross, resurrection. As sinners, we deserve death. And Jesus sacrificed himself on the cross on behalf of us. He made an atonement. What is an atonement? An atonement is a process of removing what's blocking our reconciliation with God. It's about mercy and grace. Mercy is not getting what we deserve. Our sin separated us from God. Eternal death. Mercy is not getting that eternal death. Grace is getting what we don't deserve. Grace is that receiving of the gift of Jesus' death on the cross. What a powerful, powerful grace. And that's a free gift. Jesus doesn't force it on us. Jesus doesn't say, here's a gift, open it, open it, open it. I want to watch you open it. Use it, use it. He gives it to us and lets us decide. It's up to us. I personally have never not opened a Christmas present. Personally, I don't know about you. But this is better than any of those. And I think back to my life as a younger person. I held the gift. I showed it to people when they asked. I said, yeah, I have it. I have Jesus. He's right here in this box. I have him right here. But it wasn't until I met with my mentors after realizing just how empty the world was that they were like, hey, Joel, buddy, if you open it, you're going to find something cool inside. And as I opened the scriptures, and as I prayed and I started to understand who God was, then everything changed. Everything changed. Jesus tells us these two things on the Sermon on the Mount in that famous sermon. It's the kingdom of heaven is here. And no matter what you do, no matter how good you are, you haven't done enough to earn your way to heaven. You have to exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees. But this is why I want to preface and start with free gift of God, mercy and grace. This is given to us for free. We can choose to accept it and do something with it if we want. I preface that because how to live through the kingdom of God, man, it gets really exciting, but it might sound like a bunch of rules if you don't understand how to receive it. Again, 126 times Jesus preaches on the kingdom of heaven, so it must be important. It really must be top of mind for him if he decides to devote 126 different references to it. And they're all different. They're all different. One of them is very abstract. It says, if you find a pearl of great wealth and you bury it and go and sell all your stuff and come back for that pearl, like, hold on, let me reread that. He finds a pearl of great wealth, buries it, goes back home, sells everything he has, buys that land that the pearl's hidden in. It's kind of abstract and weird. But what it gets to, the point of it, is that the kingdom of heaven is greater than anything we could ever understand. And it's worth getting rid of all our old stuff. because it's something better. The way we can live our life in the kingdom of heaven is better than the way I knew it living for the kingdom of Joel. The kingdom of Joel left me broken, left me empty, left me lonely. The kingdom of God has brought me community, life, love. It's not about rules, it's about a relationship. And really, it's kind of like instructions if you think about it. If Jesus is the creator of the world, the book of John opens up saying, the Word was with God, and the Word was with God in the beginning. The Word is God, was God, was with God. It's kind of confusing, but if you think about it, in the beginning was the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. As they created the world together, they spoke. God spoke the world into existence. That speaking was the Word, right? So if Jesus was a creator, wouldn't he know the best way for me to use my life? If he created me, maybe he knows better than I do how I should live, what I should do. So in sharing these messages throughout the Gospels of the kingdom of heaven, he opens up different opportunities for understanding insight into how he's created us. You know, just like I might have my own thoughts and feelings about how I should live my life and his are different, I'm sure Simon the Zealot, again, looking at those Clydesdales, was like, that's a big horse. You sure we don't want that instead of this tiny little donkey? But he submitted to God. He submitted to Jesus, and it was better. Different, much different, but it was better. So in this season of life, I've done full-time ministry. I've been vocationally involved, and I've done some volunteering part-time stuff as well. And this season, I'm what the Apostle Paul would call a tent maker. Not physically making tents. I sell software. But in my day job, in my 9-to-5, I have the opportunity to show people something very cool and tell them that they need it. And it doesn't really matter the what it does if they don't understand why it's important to them. And that's a lot like the gospel for us, right? If we just say what it is, it might sound like rules. If we say why it is, we understand, oh, this brings me into relationship with God. This is how I was created to live. Imagine you've never seen an iPhone before. Your first time ever seeing an iPhone, I just hand it to you. What might you think? Wow, this picture has a clock on it. If I give it to you for a couple minutes, you might push some buttons or swipe different directions and find, oh, hey, there's a flashlight. That'll come in handy when I lose my keys in the movie theater. Or a calculator to calculate the tip at the restaurant. It has some nice things. Oh, cool, it's like a Polaroid camera, kind of, because it shows me the picture I just took, but, oh, hey, it went away. Well, I guess I never get to see that picture again. You'd have no idea what it was unless I came by and said, let me show you how to unlock this. Unlock it? Whoa, I can make a phone call? I can call my dad and tell him I love him? I can email a coworker something really important? I can search the internet and learn anything that's ever been created or invented ever? Wow, this is so much more than just a picture with a clock on it. What's your Christianity like? What's your version of living this Christian life like? Do you have a picture with a clock on it? And maybe a flashlight? Or have you unlocked that phone and started using it? The kingdom of heaven is teaching us how to unlock that phone. If the kingdom of heaven is instructions, how do we understand it? What do we need to do? We need to read it, right? A preacher on a pulpit is 40 minutes on a Sunday. Have you spent 40 minutes with your with your significant other, would they think you liked them very much? Would you know very much about them? That's why I love this place. During worship, I could see people leaning in because you guys are here because you love Jesus. And if you're in here and you've never heard this before, or you are trying to figure out if maybe you love Jesus, you're shoulder to shoulder with some people who know him really well. And if you were invited here today by somebody, chances are they know him really well too. And if you want to get to know him, they can help you with that. That's my hope for you. Understanding why the kingdom of heaven is what it is important, so that we can understand the what, the following up, the doing. We want to have that right relationship with God and live the kingdom of heaven now on earth. You know, unfortunately, the closer we get to God, often the enemy, the devil, likes to mess with us. Talking with Pastor Keith about preaching here today, he shared, you know, it's no wonder that Pastor Luke's being attacked right now because of the great things that are happening at Journey Redmond. And this is God working through Luke. Luke is not some special person. Luke is a person who's just said, I'm here, God, use me. And God is using him and this community and each of you to do some great things in the city of Redmond, Oregon, transforming Central Oregon. And if it weren't for that, his life would probably be really comfortable. If you just wanted to sit on a couch all day and never share anything with anyone about Jesus, Satan might do what he can to make you feel as comfortable as possible to make that plan happen. But the second you start saying, hey, coworker, hey, neighbor, hey, cousin, hey, parent, who is Jesus to you? Can I share something amazing that's happened in my life since I've gotten to know Jesus? Be ready for attacks to happen. And they're subtle. The devil is a liar. His native tongue is lying. It's not that his native tongue is truth speaking and sometimes he lies. His native tongue is lying. And he'll give bad instructions. If you've got that locked iPhone, he might tap you on the shoulder and go, hey, did you know that's a hammer? It works great. Check it out. You should smash that nail into the wall. And if you're used to smashing a nail into a wall with the palm of your hand, maybe it seems like a great hammer. When I was a senior year in high school and I was trying to figure out life for myself, I lucked out a bunch of friends who were using iPhones as hammers, and they're like, no, it's great. It's so much better than using your palm. The thing is, for me, I knew about hammers. I knew that a hammer existed. And as a result of that knowledge, I got to the end of that going, I just broke my iPhone for what? This is stupid. But friends, some people don't know that they're built for so much more. Some people have never heard of the kingdom of heaven. Some people have never experienced Jesus. The devil's going to try and distract those people. He's going to try and distract us. But Jesus' ministry was good instruction. He created us. He knows us. He tells us how to live. Living according to God's instructions. And it's all in the Gospels, guys. Just read the Gospels. They're so good. Even Ephesians. Right now at Journey in Bend, we're going through Ephesians, and I got to preach at youth group the other night. And Paul was writing to these people because they were brand new Christians. They had no idea what to do. He had to write things like, if you've been stealing, get a job that works with your hands so you can earn money and then be able to give things to other people. Can you imagine being so brand new to Christianity? Like, yeah, I'm a pickpocketer by day. That's how I make my money. No big deal. Pretty good at it. And Paul has to say, hey, there's a better way of doing this. That's what Jesus does. Throughout the Gospels, as he shares the kingdom of heaven with us, there's a better way of doing things. James, Jesus' brother, wrote a book in the Bible. He puts it really bluntly. He says, do not merely listen to the words and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Actions speak louder than words. It's not the thought that counts. In Matthew 21, verses 28 through 32, we hear a parable of a father who asks his sons to go work in the vineyard. The first son, he says, hey, would you mind going to work in the vineyard? And that son says, no. And then later in the day, goes out and works in the vineyard. The father goes to the second son and says, hey, do you mind going working in the vineyard? And he goes, yes, right away, sir. I will be right there. And he never makes it out. Which of those two is the better son? The one that went. Actions speak louder than words. Do it. Don't just read your Bible. Do something about it. It's all right here. The kingdom of heaven is here. It's now. It's on earth. We get to experience it. What a blessing. And Jesus doesn't leave us to figure it out alone. He doesn't say, oh, this is really confusing about the pearl thing. Yeah, good luck with that one. He gives us the Holy Spirit. The night of his crucifixion, the night of his betrayal, he was having dinner with his disciples, and he was sharing things with them, and he was telling them he was about to leave them. But he said, I will not leave you abandoned. I will leave you with the Spirit of truth. He promises us the Holy Spirit, and we receive that when we receive that gift, when we take that gift and open it and give our lives to Jesus. We receive that Holy Spirit who helps to sanctify us. And that's just a Christianese word to say he helps us learn how to do the thing. The Holy Spirit helps us understand how to live in the kingdom of God. In Matthew 11, 29 through 30, Jesus says, take my yoke upon you, for my burden is easy and light. Following God can be really easy. I like to imagine that I'm physically yoked with a big piece of wood to God. If you yoke two oxen, you want them to be equally yoked. That way they plow straight. If they're unequally yoked, they'll plow crooked. Thankfully, in this unequally yoked scenario between me and God, he carries me. If it gets hard, and it will get hard, I can say, hey, God, you can take it from here. I'm having a tough time. And he can do that. But sometimes he doesn't. Sometimes I keep praying, Lord, take this from me, take this from me, take this from me. I need help. God, carry me, carry me. God, where are you? Carry me. And he comforts me, and he says, I'm here. I'm right here. I'm right here. Just like Simon the Zealot had some ideas. Hey, God, are you sure you don't want a horse? Jesus, the horse would be way better. No, I want a donkey. A horse would be so much cooler. No, I want a donkey. Okay. I'll get you the donkey. Trusting and obeying doesn't mean that we get to suddenly control God because, oh, heaven on earth, great. Holy Spirit living in me. God will do whatever I want. He's not a genie in a bottle. That's not who God is. He's the creator of the universe who created us and knows everything about us and knows our best way to live. And sometimes we have to go through really hard stuff in that process. We struggle and our spirit breaks, but God never abandons us. In the process of getting closer to God, we have kingdom impact on others. Paul puts it this way. In Philippians 3:8, Paul says, I consider everything else trash to following God. To someone who's never used a hammer and has only hit a nail in with the palm of their hand, using an iPhone as a hammer is a pretty good deal. But do you want to really blow their mind? Give them a hammer. Let the Holy Spirit fill your life. Submit to God. Submit your life to God and see what that looks like. It's not following rules. It's a relationship. You are who you surround yourself with. The people we surround ourselves with impact us. We've all had roommates. When I was little, my parents were my roommates. They cleaned the house. They cooked the food. It was great. It was a great situation. I loved it. It was actually fantastic. In college, I had a roommate who made the house dirty. And sometimes I might have been the roommate who made the house dirty. That impacted my life. If you're married, maybe you've realized that your way of doing things isn't the only way of doing things. And it might not even be the best way of doing things. When you get babies and toddlers, they start dictating your aesthetic design changes in your house. Wow. Yeah, you know, honey, that rounded, soft-cornered, cushiony coffee table does look a lot better than our jagged, pointy, modern-looking one. It totally looks better. And when you get middle schoolers in the house and they start destroying everything, and you can't, they're the reason you can't have nice things. They impact you, right? The people around us impact us. The people we allow in our life have impact on how we live. And we have impact on them. Can I tell you, as the clean roommate in college, my roommates loved having me there. They loved it because I took care of the house. I made it clean. And it drove me crazy being the only clean one in the house. But I did it because for me, it was the right thing to do. And as I submit my life to God over and over and over and over, I start to realize, oh, this is the right thing to do. Can we trust God? I think so. Yeah, sure. We can trust God. This summer, I started reading or praying the Lord's Prayer every morning and most days at noon. And it starts with this: Our Father in heaven. You know, just a couple words, really basic. But as I started to say that over and over and over and over and over, I started internalizing, wow, if God is my Father, then He has my best intentions in mind. And if He's in heaven and He created all this, He knows what's best for me. And as I understood that, as I understood He has my best intentions, He knows what's best for me, can I trust Him? The answer was, yeah, I can trust God. The follow-up question to that is, do I trust God? That is a harder question to answer. I had to wrestle with that one for months. I just walked through a season of transition, and in that transition, I was meeting with a mentor who said, sometimes transition is like walking across a bridge. And everyone's bridge is different. You might have a crooked bridge. You might have one of those Indiana Jones rope bridges. You might have a highway bridge that just, you know, crests in the middle. You can't quite see the other side, but you trust it because it's smooth and wide. And I said to him, I don't think I have a bridge. I think it's a trapeze bar. And I didn't think I was hearing from God. But what I realized is I was hearing loud and clear. I wasn't trusting. God was screaming to me, let go. And I was like, no, I really like this stuff. I really like my life the way it is. And He's like, I have something better. I have something so much better. I have a hammer for you. Stop breaking your phone. I have something more for you. And when I realized that not only can I trust God, but I do trust God. Whoa. I'll tell you, some things changed and some things didn't. Some things stayed hard. But my perspective in those hard things changed. God worked through it. He worked through it. Jesus will not leave you abandoned. He's given you the Holy Spirit to work out His scripture as He tells you the instructions of how to live in the kingdom of heaven. Last week, Pastor Luke spoke on Ephesians 2:19. It said, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and the members of the household of God. Fellow citizens, you belong in the kingdom of God. That's pretty cool. Most of us don't realize what we have in that. Matthew 16:19 says, I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. As the crowds were cheering, Hosanna, Hosanna to Jesus as he came in at triumphal entry, presenting himself as the Messiah, the King of the Jews, there was anticipation on their lips. There was anticipation in their hearts, expectant of what was to come. And friends, knowing the other side of that story, knowing that Jesus' death did not end the story, that he rose again and gave his life for us in a way that fixed the sin problem, his mercy and grace. That is powerful. And I'm so excited for Pastor Luke to be able to dig into that next week. It's going to be amazing. One of the problems that we have in this season of the kingdom of heaven is the now and not yet. We want everything now. Now, 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 now. They wanted that triumphal, on the horse, charging down the government, overthrowing the Romans victory. But they got a God of peace. They wanted liberation from the Romans now. They wanted a new kingdom now, but they didn't realize that the king was here to destroy death. I'll just end with the Lord's Prayer. It says, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Hallowed, revered, praised. Your kingdom will be revealed today. Your sustenance is what I need. Your forgiveness is what drives me. And your guidance is what sustains me. This is what living in the kingdom of heaven looks like." For friends who have never given their life to Jesus, if this is your first time hearing this, or maybe it's your 30th time hearing this, or your 30th year of hearing this, but you haven't opened that present yet. If you haven't received it or you haven't opened it, guys, here's an opportunity for you. I want you to be a part of this kingdom of heaven. I want you to experience life with God. If you guys would just close your eyes and bow your heads, I want to give those folks an opportunity. If this is you, you've never received the gift of life through Jesus Christ. You've never given your life over to him. You've never received that gift, or you've never opened it. And you want to. You want that. You want to live that life with God. Would you just raise your hand right now? Would you just raise your hand? Raise it high. We've got some friends around the room who are going to, we want to make sure we connect with you. We want to make sure we connect with you after this service so that you can figure out some next steps on what that looks like, guys. This is so exciting. I want to pray for you right now, and I just ask that you would pray this with me. God, I am a sinner in need of a Savior, and I welcome the gift that you brought. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for my sins that I might live heaven on earth and heaven in eternity with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wow, what a wonderful message, Joel, and what a wonderful opportunity to receive Jesus. Hey, listen, unlock that phone and live in the reality of Jesus today. I tell you, there's just nothing like it. Hey, if you prayed that prayer today, if you received Jesus' salvation, if you said, that was me, I need that, then all you got to do, the Bible says, like Joel said, just pray within. The Bible says that those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's not a formula you got to do. It's not one right thing you got to say. There's not a special verbiage that gets you into heaven. It's putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Romans 10 is implicitly clear that if you believe with your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and raised from the dead, you shall be saved. That's what we put our faith, we put our trust in. And today, we as you prayed with Joel today, I believe that God's doing something great and God's doing something significant in and through you. I want you to hear this though. You didn't arrive at your destination. Heaven is in your future. You started a journey. That's why we call this church journey, is because it's a journey of faith with Jesus. It's a journey of ups. It's a journey of downs and ins and outs. And there's all sorts of different parts in between. And God never created you to do this journey alone. He never set you out to do this by yourself. yourself. That's what the church comes together to do, is we embark on this journey together. And one of the best things you can possibly do is to tell somebody about your decision to follow Jesus Christ. And that would, we would love to be that, that would, we would love that to be us. We've got the connection cards in the seats that are in front of you, that you can grab one of those. You can write your name in there, check the little box that says I'm committing my life to the Lord, or you can simply pull out your cell phone, since you know how to unlock that bad boy, and text the word life. All you got to do is text the word life to 541-600-2546. That's our text number here at Journey. And that just lets us know. It'll shoot you back and just says, congratulations. We just love to get your name and some information. Here's our commitment to you. We want to go before God on your behalf. We want to pray for you. You're starting a brand new journey out, and the devil don't want you on that journey. You need some people to get behind you, to pray for you, to pray for strength and encouragement, to pray God's plan to be enacted in and through your life. And we would love and be honored to do that. We got some great prayer warriors that would love to be a part of that. We also would love to equip you if you need something. If you need a Bible, we'll get a Bible into your hands. We'd love to just let you know we're here for you. We're on your team. We'd love to be in your corner on this new journey of faith in Jesus Christ. If you did pray today a prayer of salvation, to ask Jesus or make a commitment to follow Jesus, listen, I don't want you to leave today empty-handed. On the backside of both sides of the auditorium are our bookshelves where there's Bibles. Grab a Bible if you need it, as well as a little devotional book called Your Next 7 Days. It's gray and orange. It's totally free. I want you to just grab one of those off the bookshelf as you leave today and take it home. Here's what it is. It's a 7-day reading plan about what life in Jesus Christ looks like now that you've just said yes. You're going to walk out of this room and say, what do I do next? The next 7 days is going to help point you in the right direction on the journey of faith. And we want to invite you to take that home, read it. It's about 5 minutes every day. Pray on it. Just listen to what God has for you. And then I want to invite you, come back and let's hang out together. Let's grow together in the ways of God on this amazing journey of faith in Jesus Christ. Can we celebrate that one more time? Come on. Well, hey, why don't you stand on your feet? We're going to let you go. We've got some amazing prayer leaders on both sides of the auditorium that are making their way over to their prayer banners. If you're in need of prayer, if you're going through something in life today, listen, it would be an honor for us to pray for you, to pray with you. Don't leave this place without having an interaction with somebody. That would be just a pleasure for us to go before God on your behalf and pray for you. So on both sides of the auditorium, we've got that. You can make your way there right now before the traffic goes in the other direction. And also don't forget, we don't have Pursuit this week. We have Good Friday at 6 o'clock on Friday. We're going to commemorate in communion together the cross and the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. And Easter Sunday, coming up this Sunday, this next week at Ridgeview High School, it's going to be a blast. Who are you inviting? I just can't wait to see you there. I'm going to pray a prayer of blessing over you today. Father, I thank you for the saints of God who are here today. Lord, would you bless them? God, would you keep them? Would you cause your face and your countenance, God, to shine upon them? And Lord, would you give them peace in Jesus' name? Amen. Amen. Hey, we'll see you next week. Happy Easter at Journey Church.
prison status. Don't have a place here. Thy repetitions fade, but you remain the same. Words and opinions are nothing but white noise. I only hear your voice.